David Gregory, would you stand up? David Gregory is the legendary professor of labor and employment law and director of their center at the St. John's University School of Law. Yay. And a co-sponsor of this conference. Sorry.
No, not at all. So first I'd like to thank NYU, St. John's and Cornell, David Gregory, Esther Bigler, Sam Estreicher. I mean, one of the great things about being in New York City is that there's as much good labor and employment law here as anywhere in the country. These individuals not only keep us up to date on the very latest developments with the fine programs and work that they do at each of their organizations, but they're kind enough to bring us together from time to time and call on the best and the brightest to talk to us about these developments, and I think we all owe them a debt of gratitude for that. It's with great pleasure that I have the honor to introduce the Acting General Counsel of the National Labor Relations Board, Lafe Solomon. Lafe and I have been friends for more than 25 years. I was younger then. Lafe was on the board staff when I went to the NLRB in 1985. Lafe is a 1970 graduate of Brown University. He's a 1976 graduate of Tulane Law School. During the time that Lafe was at the NLRB, I had come from private practice in Connecticut. I'd been a partner at Wigan and Dana. During the time that I was at the NLRB, there were a handful of people who were known for the high quality of their work and the quality of their thinking. And I can say without any reservation that during that time and since, Lafe has distinguished himself by his intellect, his deep and broad understanding of NLRA law, and his perspective. He's a very practical and wise fellow. In addition, for those of us who have been lucky enough to get to know him, he has a wonderful sense of humor, which, as we all know, is an absolute prerequisite to doing anything in Washington these days. And he really has made a phenomenal contribution to the NLRB. This has, as we know, and everybody in this room knows, this is a difficult and challenging time for anyone to serve, but it's particularly challenging at the National Labor Relations Board. And while any one of us may disagree with a particular decision in a particular case, I can tell you without any fear of contradiction that there's not a doubt in my mind that in every instance, large or small, known or unknown, popular or not, that Lafe Solomon is going to make the decision that he believes that the act requires. Without further ado, Lafe Solomon.
Good job. Let's try this again. Can you hear me? Thank you, Marshall. Marshall and Sam have given me invaluable advice this past 3 years. I don't always take it, but I do value it. I want to acknowledge in the audience, we have, did we lose Karen? Oh, Karen, okay, we have Karen Fernback, a regional director in Manhattan, Jim Paulson, regional director in Brooklyn. We have employees at both offices here, and we even have two from headquarters. So I thank you all for coming. I thank you, David, and I thank you, Esther. I have some prepared remarks and that I'd like to give, and then I'll be happy to open it up to questions, if you have any. I am honored to be part of this conference marking the 75th anniversary of the Fair Labor Standards Act. The FLSA, like the National Labor Relations Act, was enacted by Congress to address the inequities in the workplace that existed in the 1930s, and Congress's vision proved to work. The middle class grew by increasing the wage scale for all workers, both unionized and non-unionized. The wage disparity between rich and poor lessened, and safer working conditions became the norm, such as the 40-hour work week. In my humble opinion, these statutes are as important today to address these issues as they were in the 30s and 40s. But there are in our society today vocal critics of both statutes. While I will leave to others at this conference to debate and defend the FLSA, I would like to address the current state of affairs in which the NLRB finds itself. The NLRB is truly at an unprecedented place in its 78-year history. We are being attacked judicially, politically, and legislatively, and each is interrelated. Starting with the judicial attacks, as you all know quite well, President Obama made three recess appointments to the board on January 4th, 2012. And on January 25th of this year, the DC Circuit Court of Appeals in Noel Canning struck down those intra-session recess appointments as invalid under the Constitution. Further, the DC Circuit put all of their pending NLRB cases, which now number about 70, in abeyance. The Justice Department, which is handling the recess litigation on behalf of the board, filed a petition for certiorari with the Supreme Court on April 25th, and I expect the court to grant cert, given the magnitude of the constitutional issues raised, the fact that, as the DC Circuit acknowledged, there is a split in circuit law on these issues, and the far-reaching impact of this decision, not only on the NLRB, but on the filling of vacancies throughout the federal government. The Congressional Research Service reported that since 1981, 329 intra-session appointments have been made by both Republican and Democratic presidents, all of which would be invalid under the Noel Canning decision. The recess issue has been raised in every circuit court of appeals, and on May 16th, the Third Circuit in New Vista Nursing agreed with the DC Circuit's analysis and held that former member Becker's intra-session recess appointment in March 2010 was invalid. The recess issue has been argued in the Second, Fourth, Fifth, Seventh, and Eighth Circuits, and we are awaiting decisions. Since the Noel Canning decision, the recess issue has been raised as a defense in unfair labor practice cases and representation cases in our field offices. Specifically, as of yesterday, the issue has been raised in 188 unfair labor practice cases and 29 representation cases in various forms. The most straightforward form is that the board has no authority to rule on any motion, such as a motion to revoke a subpoena, or issue any decision, such as the denial of a request for review in a representation case. But employers are also raising as a defense that administrative law judges and hearing officers have no authority to conduct hearings. A similar argument was raised in the two-member board litigation, which led to the New Process Steel Supreme Court decision. And in our opinion, the Supreme Court rejected the argument that once the board loses a quorum, all delegations from the board cease to operate. There are also attacks on the authority of the 10 regional directors, including the two here, who have been appointed by this board or by the previous board, including former member Becker, as well as on my authority to act. Of course, the latter is of great interest to me because my connection to the Noel Canning analysis is not obvious. I have never received a recess appointment. Rather, I was appointed under the Federal Vacancies Act, which to date has not been declared unconstitutional. There have also been attacks on my authority to seek 10J injunctive relief. And in defense, we are relying not only on my delegation of authority from the prior board, but also that board's reliance on prior delegations of prior boards to prior general counsels. The more significant challenges that have been made are upon to the law upon which we have based our complaints, such as D.R. Horton, the board decision that class action waivers violate the act, the social media decisions, and the board's reversals of board law made by the current board, such as the reversals of Bethlehem Steel, which is about dues checkoff surviving contract expiration, and Anheuser-Busch about witness statements provided to the unions in grievance proceedings. There is no statute of limitations to seek review of board decisions, and therefore all board decisions issued by the current board since January 4th of 2012, as well as the decisions since 2010, in which former member Becker participated on a panel, are subject to attack in future cases. There have also been collateral attacks filed in the DC Circuit to stop our administrative proceedings. Employers have filed motions and representation cases to stop the holding of an election and to stop the counting of determinative challenge ballots, and in unfair labor practice cases to stop 10J proceedings and to stop UOP hearings. To date, we have been successful in persuading the court to allow representation cases to proceed, but the court has scheduled briefing and oral argument in the unfair labor practice cases. But I don't want to leave you with the impression that post-Noel Canning, the agency has ground to a halt. To the contrary, every day we are holding elections, conducting investigations, and issuing complaints. Although the recess issue has been raised in about 220 cases, those cases represent but a small percentage of the 2,000 unfair labor practice charges and 200 representation petitions filed every month in our regional offices. The vast majority of employers are still consenting to elections, and we are still experiencing a 90%+ settlement rate on our complaints. And employers are filing for review of board orders in circuits other than the DC Circuit, where they know the court would automatically put the case in abeyance. My firm belief is that win, lose, or draw, most employers would rather have their workplace disputes resolved by us than have them fester for years with back pay and interest continuing to accrue. We saw a similar pattern emerge after the Supreme Court's new process steel decision. Even though the court's decision invalidated the 600 decisions decided by the two-member board, only 100 of those cases needed to be redecided by the subsequent board because the parties in the remaining 500 cases had no desire to reopen and relitigate those cases. Now, turning to the political front, the president has nominated 5 board members, the 3 sitting Democrats and 2 Republicans. The Senate Help Committee has approved all 5 and sent them to the floor for a confirmation vote. But given the immigration debate, I don't expect consideration of the board nominations until July. And as an aside, as Marshall said, the president renominated me as general counsel on May 23rd, and I will continue as acting general counsel while my nomination is pending before the Senate. Confirmation of the board members is of critical importance because Chairman Pierce's term expires on August 27th. Therefore, without confirmations, and regardless of the recess litigation, on August 28th, the board will have only 2 members And we now know from the Supreme Court's decision in New Process Steel that two members cannot continue to issue rulings and decisions. And the recess appointments of members Block and Griffin expire at the end of this session of Congress, probably in December. Further, even assuming that the Supreme Court grants cert in Noel Canning, I don't think we can expect a decision until at least the spring of 2014. So, for the first time in the board's 78-year history, there is a possibility of no board. And unfortunately, there are critics of the board who agree with one senator who stated, and I quote, "The NLRB as inoperable could be considered progress." And finally, on the legislative front, the House on April 15th passed, and this is the name of it, Preventing Greater Uncertainty in Labor Management Relations Act, which would prohibit the board from taking any action until the Senate confirms board members or the Supreme Court decides Noel Canning. A companion bill has been introduced in the Senate, but there's a good chance that it will die. Meanwhile, although directed at all federal agencies, sequester has meant a $14.5 million cut in our budget this year, and it's anyone's guess at this point what our budget will be next year and whether we will have to absorb further cuts, which will have a direct negative impact on our ability to carry out our mission. I would like to conclude my remarks as I began them. The National Labor Relations Act and its enforcement is as critical today to address the economic issues facing this country as it was in 1935. The NLRB plays an important part in improving labor management relations and resolving workplace disputes by, as stated in the preamble of the Act, encouraging the practice and procedure of collective bargaining. In fiscal year 2012 alone, we collected more than $44 million in back pay or reimbursement of fees, dues, and fines, and 1,241 employees were offered reinstatement. And since October 2010, our 10J Nip in the Bud initiative has resulted in collecting almost $4 million in back pay and 580 offers of reinstatement to workers fired during union organization campaigns. I firmly believe today, as those enacting the National Labor Relations Act did in 1935, that the NLRB's resolution of these workplace disputes can only help to improve the chasm between the haves and the have-nots in our society, thereby improving the economic landscape for all of us nationwide. Through all of the political attacks that have come, and those that have yet to come, I and all the NLRB employees here and those not here remain committed to resolving workplace disputes and giving employers and employees the due process that they desire. It is my fervent hope that, in the words of Mr. Spock in Star Trek, the NLRB lives long and prospers for the sake of the working men and women in this country and for the economic and social well-being of each of us and our country. Thank you. I would be happy to answer any questions you may have over any of that or anything else. Yes.
Why do you think that the Wall Street Journal hates the National Labor Relations Act?
I am not going to render an opinion. There are reporters in this room.
Terry. Yes.
Are there any cases in the pipeline with boards looking at this, once again, extending the wine dark nights to non-union employees?
To my knowledge, no. I don't know of any.
Any other questions, comments? Lafe, thank you. On behalf of the Center for Labor and Employment Law and all the folks that you spoke on behalf of, thank you for everything.
Thank you.